Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty,
who was and is to come.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts.
The whole earth is full of his glory.
Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God, saying,
Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which you ought to have done, and we have done those things which you ought not to have done, and there is no health in us. But you, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare those, O God, who confess their faults. Restore those who are penitent, according to your promises declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desires not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, has given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people being penitent the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardons and absolves all those who truly repent and genuinely believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beg him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our first lesson is taken from the 23rd chapter of the book of Jeremiah, beginning at the 23rd verse.
Am I a God at hand, declares the Lord, and not a God far away? Can a man hide himself in secret places so that I cannot see him, declares the Lord? Do I not fill heaven and earth, declares the Lord? I have heard what the prophets have said, who prophesy lies in my name, saying, I have dreamed, I have dreamed. How long shall there be lies in the heart of the prophets who prophesy lies, and who prophesy the deceit of their own heart? Who think to make my people forget my name by their dreams that they tell one another, even as their fathers forget my name for Baal? Let the prophet who has a dream tell the dream, but let him who has my word speak my word faithfully. What has straw in common with wheat, declares the Lord? Is not my word like fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces? Therefore, behold, I am against the prophets, declares the Lord, who steal my words from one another. Behold, I am against the prophets, declares the Lord, who use their tongues and declare, declares the Lord. Behold, I am against those who prophesy lying dreams, declares the Lord, who tell them and lead my people astray by their lies and their recklessness, when I did not send them or charge them. So they do not profit this people at all, declares the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Magnify the Lord with me, let us exalt his name. Oh, taste and see, the Lord is good. How blessed those who trust in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you saints of God. There is no want if we fear him.
second lesson is taken from the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 16, beginning at the 19th verse.
There was a rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen, and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate was laid a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who desired to be fed with what fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, even the dogs came and licked his sores. The poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. And in Hades, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. And he called out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in anguish in this flame." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that you in your lifetime received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner bad things. But now he is comforted there, and you are in anguish. And besides all this, between us and you a great chasm has been fixed, in order that those who would pass from here to you may not be able, and none may cross from here to us." And he said, "Then I beg you, Father, to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they also come into this place of torment." But Abraham said, "They have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them." And he said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent." He said to them, "If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Make a joyful noise unto the Lord now, all you people. Serve the Lord with gladness, come into his presence singing. Know for sure the Lord is God, and he made us, and we ourselves. We're his people, and like sheep we dwell within his pastures. Come into his courts with praise, be thankful as you enter. Bless his name, for he is good, his love endures forever. His great faithfulness and goodness will continue without end. He will bless and keep us now and generations.
Let us now recite our profession of faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning. This morning we have the opportunity to look at a parable which has a lot more depth than sometimes we give it credit for. The parable of the rich man and Lazarus. And I'll get to why it's dot, dot, dot and Lazarus as we go through. But one of the quotes Jesus gives here is one that people have a hard time understanding and certainly a hard time accepting because it goes against our inclination. Jesus says, if they do not hear Moses, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead. So as we go into this particular message and start digging through Jesus' parable, I want you to consider why quite obviously, it goes against our common sense, and yet it is so absolutely true. And now let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. This morning, I want to review what we read in our gospel lesson, the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. And remember, when you're examining a passage of scripture, and I'm sure I've said this before, and I'm sure I will say it many more times, context is key. Our gospel lesson comes from Luke chapter 16, where we are told that the Pharisees had come to listen to Jesus. But as you can guess, when they come to listen, they are not there to learn. They are there to argue, to mock, to heckle, to try to find some quotes they can take out of context, to insult him back and forth amongst each other, hoping he doesn't hear. When they get called on that so many times, their goal is to try to get the people who seem to be flocking to Jesus to stop listening to him and to listen to them. As we roll through this parable, you can keep this other subtitle in mind, the parable of the bad shepherd. That's what we saw in Jeremiah chapter 23, where God is calling down a condemnation on the bad shepherds, the ones who were not leading the people to God. And this is a perfect example we have in the form of the Pharisees. Throughout the Gospels, we see time after time how the Pharisees have come to Jesus, trying to trick him or to trip him up or simply to insult him to anyone who would listen to them. And every time, pretty much, they go away with their tail between their legs, embarrassed and humiliated. This morning, Jesus is telling us a story specifically as a warning against the Pharisees. It's also a warning for us as well. The Pharisees were lovers of money first and foremost, and they were lovers of acclaim second. Acclaim meaning being seen as wise or great in the eyes of the public. Luke tells us this, interestingly, 5 verses before the parable in Luke 16:14, that these are the type of people who Jesus is dealing with. The story begins with a rich man and a poor man. The rich man, hopefully you will see as we walk through the parable, is a representative of the Pharisees. They were rich in a number of ways. First, they were rich in terms of being big on raising taxes. Now you'll say to yourself, how in the world can raising taxes make you rich? Well, it makes you rich if you are the receiver of the government largesse from raising the taxes. They loved to see high taxes from the people, and they would use the tax money to support their schools of teaching and learning to enable them to have a lifestyle of sitting around the temple and arguing theology all day. They were also rich in having at least a superficial knowledge of the Bible. And I want you to remember, because this is a very key point, they've memorized large portions of the scripture. They've used the scripture in their daily prayers. In a sense, you could say they feasted daily on the Bible. However, instead of changing their hearts and molding their life, they used knowledge of the Bible as an end in and of itself to compete with, to argue with others, not to repent, not to share God's message with those who did not have that kind of life, the type of people Jesus calls the poor in spirit. So there is a great application, and I'm hoping you'll catch it as we walk through, that
Jesus is talking here about people who are rich in terms of knowledge of the scripture, rich in terms of having a job where they could teach the scriptures to those who were poor in their knowledge of the scriptures and in their opportunity to learn them. We have Lazarus, of course, too. He's described as a beggar who is covered with sores, who sat at the rich man's gate. He fed on the crumbs that fell from the rich man's table. And you can see this analogy spiritually, as I said, representing those who are poor in spirit, those who do not have a life where they can hear God's word and are in need of those, like the Pharisees, who have a life of being able to share it with them. They are people who Jesus describes, if they had the opportunity to hear God's word, they would consume every crumb that they could. You can set a good example of these type of people in the story of Mary and Martha, which takes place a few chapters before this lesson, where Mary refused to do anything but to sit and listen to Jesus. We have a pattern there of a woman, poor in spirit, who's coming to hear God's word. They were supposed to be fed by the rich, but the rich, in the form of the Pharisees, kept it to themselves to ensure their position. Again, a beautiful reflection of our Old Testament lesson from Jeremiah 23. So both of these men died, the rich man going to the place of torment, and Lazarus, who went to the bosom of Abraham. Now, for the purposes of this story, again, this is a parable, not a factual event. The rich man is able to talk to Abraham. So he calls out to him, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in anguish in this flame." So two things to pick up here. First, he knows Abraham as father. In fact, Abraham refers back to him as son or child, depending upon the translation you use. One thing this teaches is another concept Christ keeps trying to teach the Pharisees, that being a child of Abraham is supposed to be more than just a genetic trait. Just in the same way that our relationship with God is more than simply following the footsteps of our parents. Being a descendant of Abraham meant pretty much nothing for the rich man as far as his eternal destination was concerned. The second interesting note is that the rich man referred to Lazarus by name. This cannot be overstated. All that time that the poor man was sitting outside of his gates, all the time he was eating scraps, all the time he was having his sores licked by dogs, the rich man, who had more than enough to live on, knew exactly who he was, knew exactly what type of a life he lived, and he couldn't care enough to care to feed the man, to care for his wounds, even to give him a meal every once in a while, just to help him out. Abraham responded, saying, "Child, remember that in your lifetime you received good things, and Lazarus in like manner bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in anguish. And besides all this, between you and us is a great chasm, which has been fixed in order that those who would pass from here to you may not be able to." After Abraham refuses the rich man's request, the rich man suddenly considers his situation and becomes an evangelist for us. He begs Abraham to send Lazarus to his brothers, to the other Pharisees, who should have known better, having feasted their whole life on God's word,
but they ended up missing its message and its point to warn them so that they would not end up in torment with him. Certainly, the rich man replies to Abraham, if someone were to raise up from the dead, they would repent. And here Abraham responds where I began our sermon, saying, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, of course this means the Bible, Moses meaning the first five books, the Torah, and the prophets meaning the history books, the prophetic books, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead. Now, I think at first hearing this, it sounds so wrong. Obviously, since Jesus said it, it must be true, and we'll examine why it's true in a second. But don't we really want to argue this particular point? And I think part of it comes from our frustration in trying to share the gospel with others, and really trying to have a good faith in and of ourselves. Which do you think would carry more weight with you? An incredible experience where we see someone rise up from the dead to attest to God's goodness and his wonderful future for us versus a future of torment based on our rejection of him. A firsthand narrative of the afterlife based on the miraculous. Or, second, hearing the word of God read and preached. I think everyone here would instantly think that that first approach would be the better. We love the dramatic, the unbelievable, the miraculous. People were seeking after Jesus for the miraculous all the time. And Jesus speaks so often how they look for signs, but they're not looking for God. They want a sign from heaven. That'll get people to believe. Imagine that I'm not a Christian for a second, and somebody knocks on my door some evening, and when I open it, I'm shocked to see a man whose funeral I attended a week before standing there. He says to me, "Hi, I've come to talk to you about Jesus. May I come in?" After my initial shock, I say, "Of course you can come in." The man begins to say, "I've just come back from heaven to especially warn you that there is a hell, and your older brother is there right now. He asked me to come to you to warn you not to come to that place. So if you will admit that you are a sinner and turn from your sin and trust Jesus today, you can be forgiven. Would you like to turn to Christ now?" On the flip side of this, another preacher on this passage I read said he really wished that he could let his church members spend 30 seconds in hell. Since those of us who know the Lord are going to heaven anyway, these 30 seconds would only serve to make us keenly aware of the peril which lays before those around us who do not know the Lord. If we could miraculously see their agony and hear their voices, we would turn and be the most effective evangelists on earth for the sake of the lost, this particular preacher believed. With that said, Jesus' point here is that neither of these miracles really matters. What matters is the openness or the closedness of our hearts to what God had to say through his word. Abraham sadly replies to the rich man, and to what we think would be just common sense, that if they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced even if someone rises from the dead. And to show this, all we have to do is look at the poor man in the parable. Especially in parables, I encourage people to pay careful attention to every detail and word that Jesus says. And that's because parables are not historic events. So when Jesus mentions something,
he is including it intentionally for us to pick it up. He could pick any name he wanted for the man who had died. He could have picked Jack or Judy, but he intentionally picks Lazarus. And to add to that, if you know your parables, you know that in no other parable does he actually give any particular person a name. Only here. He wants us to know that the man who goes to be in the bosom of Abraham is named Lazarus. We don't know the Good Samaritan's name. We don't know the prodigal son's name, but we know Lazarus. So that name is probably pretty important. And here's my point, a point that a lot of people can miss. Right before Jesus' death, not long after teaching this particular parable, he performed a miracle involving Lazarus. Not Lazarus, a beggar, but Lazarus, the brother of Mary and Martha. Lazarus, the brother of the people who were the symbol of being poor in spirit. Lazarus was dead, and Jesus wept not only because his friend had died, but because Jesus knew that his miracle wouldn't change a thing. The people would still cry out, "Crucify him," rejecting their Messiah. Lazarus is raised from the dead in front of a great many people, people who smelled and reported the decay that came from the tomb. And yet the teachers of the law, the men who were rich in God's word, would not believe and would not see this as a clear sign from God of how he was keeping his promise to Abraham. In fact, some of them planned out how they needed not just to kill Jesus, but they also needed to kill Lazarus, because Lazarus was an obvious sign of Jesus' power over death and life. When they got proof, Lazarus rising from the dead, they chose instead to look the other way. The rich man of the parable urges Abraham, if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent. And yet, when the real life Lazarus rises from the dead to attest to Jesus' authority, he, as well as Jesus, was rejected. And they plotted his death as well. Miracles can attest to the authority of the prophet, but miracles can't produce conversion. The only thing that can change us is to have faith in Christ, to accept Christ as our Lord and Savior. When we realize that it is God's persuasiveness and not our persuasiveness that brings people to their senses, when we realize it's the work of the Holy Spirit and not our wisdom, we can breathe a sigh of relief and go about telling people the good news. Because God opens eyes and hearts. God raises the spiritual dead to life. He draws sinners to the cross. God is the one responsible for the saving. Our job is simply to follow his command to share this message with others. It's not a great dramatic event. It's not great wise words. It's the work of the Holy Spirit. And our job, being rich in the knowledge and understanding of God's word, is not to be like the Pharisees and keep it to ourselves and use it to puff up our wisdom, but simply to share it with those who are the poor in spirit, those who are poor in their knowledge of who God is. So on hearing Jesus' commission today, let us pray that we may be faithful
and sharing his good news, trusting him to let his word do the work he sent it to. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that we who have been made rich by your Holy Spirit may follow in the ways of the apostles and disciples of Christ and sharing that no matter what the consequences in our life, and not follow those who seek to keep your word to themselves. Help us, Lord, to be faithful sharers of your great commission. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
O creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Alleluia, Alleluia. The burning sun with golden beam, the silver moon with softer gleam, oh, praise him. Oh, praise him. Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia.
The rushing wind that
roars so strong, the rushing wind that roars so strong,
he draws our sail in
heaven alone.
Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, who alone makes men to be of one mind in a house, and stills the outrage of a violent and unruly people, we bless your holy name and ask that it would please you to appease the seditious tumults which have lately raised up amongst us, most humbly begging you to grant us grace that we may obediently walk in your holy commandments, lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty, and continually offer unto you our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. For these your mercies towards us, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
O most mighty and merciful God, to whom alone belong the issues of life and death,
in this time of grievous sickness, we flee unto you for relief. Deliver us, we beg you, from our peril. Give strength and skill to your ministers of healing. Bless the means of cure, and grant that, perceiving how frail is our earthly life,
we may apply our hearts unto that heavenly wisdom which leads to eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
O Lord, our heavenly Father, the high and mighty ruler of the universe, who does from your throne behold all the dwellers upon earth, most heartily we beg you with your favor to behold and bless your servant Donald Trump, our president, our Senate and representatives in Congress assembled, Philip Murphy, the governor of New Jersey, Tom Wolf, the governor of Pennsylvania, and all others in authority, and so replenish them with the grace of your Holy Spirit that they may always incline to your will and walk in your way. Empower them plenteously with heavenly gifts. Grant them in health and prosperity long to live, and finally, after this life, to attain everlasting joy and happiness through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, the strong tower and refuge of your people, we entreat your favor upon the officers and all who are enlisted in the service of defense of our country. Ever spare them from being ordered into a war of aggression or oppression. Use them, if need be, as your instruments in the defense of our national life and liberty. By restraining, we beg you, the greed and wrath of man, that wars may cease in all the earth. Watch over also all policemen and law enforcement officers everywhere, especially Tim Richfalski. Protect them from harm in the performance of their duty. We pray also for firefighters, first responders, and healthcare workers, who protect us and ours from all types of danger. Give these men and women the courage and skills to carry out their duties well and safely. When they must go into the face of danger, be by their side. Watch over their families, reminding them that those who go into danger are in your loving care. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Almighty and everlasting God, from whom comes every good and perfect gift, send down upon our bishops, especially Foley, Ray, Chuck, and other clergy, and upon the congregations committed to their charge, the helpful spirit of your grace, and that they may truly please you, pour upon them the continual dew of your blessing. Grant this, O Lord, for the honor of our advocate and mediator, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
O God, the creator and preserver of all mankind, we humbly beg you for all sorts and conditions of men, that you would be pleased to make your ways known unto them, your saving health unto all nations. More especially, we pray for your holy church universal, that it may be so guided and governed by your good spirit,
that all who profess and call themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth, and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life. Finally, we commend to your fatherly goodness all those who are in any ways afflicted or distressed, in mind, body, or estate, especially those for whom our prayers are desired. We pray, Lord, for St. John's and other churches who are going through financial struggles during this time, for Dolores Mitchell, Mary Hudson, Gina Martinez, for Kyle Coble, who was in a car accident, and his family, for our friends and family who own businesses that have been greatly affected by the virus, especially Heather and Al, Larry, Mark, Roy, and Bill, for Rachel, Dominic, Heather and Grace, Ariel and Oliver, Noah, Jonathan, Brian, and for Sydney and Nick, who have both gotten new jobs this week, that they may be excellent in their work, and for Lynn Blitz. We pray for all who have been so greatly affected by the coronavirus, especially Marie Young West and Emily and Rob Marble, both of whom are nurses who have gotten the coronavirus while helping patients who have had it, and for Kim Jenkins, Emily's mother, for Ron, who is in hospice, for Jean, for Ted and Midge, for Ada Barber, who has been moved to the ICU this week with a broken leg and shoulder in addition to a kidney shutdown and bone cancer, for Audrey Cox, the granddaughter of Bishop Cox, and especially that the cause of her sickness may be figured out, and for all those who have risked sickness to provide for others at this time,
that it may please you to comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, giving them patience under their sufferings and a happy issue out of all their afflictions. And this we beg for Jesus Christ's sake.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of all your mercies that our hearts may be truly thankful, and that we may declare your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Almighty God, you have promised to hear the petitions of those who ask in your Son's name. Mercifully accept us who have now made our prayers and petitions to you, and grant that those things which we have asked in faith according to your will, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost, be with us all evermore. Amen.
The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Please remember to support your local parish at this time, especially as most parishes are not able to meet together. It's easy not to remember. If you are part of the St. John's family or you wish to support our ministry, you may do so at the link below or by mailing your checks to St. John's Church. Also, while you're checking out below, please, if you are not subscribed already, please subscribe to St. John's by the Sea and click on the bell icon after you subscribe. Also, feel free to like the videos. That's always a nice thing, and it helps the videos to get promoted through YouTube.
Thank you for visiting St. John's by the Sea Church.
Did you get that one?
This is Carter and Noah. This is Carter and Noah. St. John. This is...
This is Cardano. Thank you for visiting St. John's by the Sea Church. This is Cardano. Thank you for visiting St. John's by the Sea Church. This is Cardano. Thank you for visiting St. John's by the Sea Church.